to welcome them here. You obviously found your way. G'day, Mike. How are you? Good to see you. So, there's Jordan. G'day, Jordan. I'm Dave. So, I think we're going to be in for a treat tonight. I'm sure we're going to get an amazing overview of what's happening around the world in the kingdom. You all come here to hear Dean Briggs, and he's just spending some time alone, just getting himself ready. So we're going to have a time of worship to start with, and just a bit of housekeeping. Toilets are here to the right hand side, ladies and men's, and we have water somewhere. We've got water bottles as well that you can avail yourself to. I think there's some casks around the place as well, so just avail yourself to some water. And we're going to have some spiritual water tonight. I just wanted to, I felt to read the scripture tonight just to encourage us. Just out of 1 Thessalonians. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. And after that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. The Lord's coming soon. And it's a time for us to be alert and ready, keeping watch for his return. So we're going to spend 15, 20 minutes just worshiping the King tonight before Dean comes to address us. So if you'd like to stand up now, just join me in prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for what you have done for us. We thank you for laying down your life. We thank you for offering up your body as a sacrifice for our sins. Lord, we could never, ever repay you for what you have done, except to offer ourselves to you as living sacrifices. And we are encouraged by your words that you will be returning soon with a loud shout. You will let the world know that you are Lord. And so we come to worship you tonight. We say, worthy is the Lamb who was slain from before the foundation of the earth. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing, honor, praise, dominion, power, and might. We will lift up our voices now in praise to your name. Father, for the plan of redemption that you have brought to all mankind on the earth, for the time that we are living in, for the harvest that is before us, to you, the Lamb, we give you our praise tonight. Thank you, Lord.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Let's sing it again. And the morning that you rose.
And the morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath till that stone was moved for good. For the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in.
The king.
Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb. Oh. Lord, we just thank you. King of kings, Lord of lords, we worship you, we glorify you, we exalt you. We just thank you, God, that you're sitting in the heavenly realms and you're laughing at those who plan rebellions on the earth. I just thank you this is the hour, Lord God, that you're calling your body to awaken. Lord, you're calling your body to awaken in this hour, Lord God. And I just thank you for the gifts and attributes you've given each and every one of us, Lord. Each and every one of us, God. I just sense in the spiritual realm, this is the hour for those who have an ear to hear. Let them hear. May we listen and understand what it is you're saying, Lord. May our spirits be so sensitive to your spirit, Lord God, that we wouldn't miss what it is you're asking us to do or what you're asking us to be part of. And Lord, we thank you this hour. Your name is being glorified and magnified across the whole earth. Lord, you are on the move. You are on the move. Your body is awakened. Your body is doing things she may not have done for decades, maybe centuries, Lord. But God, you've shifted things into high gear. And Lord, I just thank you that us in this room tonight, we get to hear something of your heart through a man called Dean Briggs. And Lord, this is an hour that you've orchestrated from before time. Lord, you've brought this day about. You planned this day. You planned it would be in the room. You planned whose ears, eyes, and hearts and spirit would be open to what it is you're saying in this hour. So we thank you for your goodness and your grace. We thank you for your kindness towards us. You're such a good, good God. You're such a good, good God. We love you. We love you, Father. We love you, Jesus. We love you, Holy Spirit. And Holy Spirit, most of all, have your way tonight. Have your way tonight, Holy Spirit. If you prompt and you nudge Dean to go a certain way, I know that it'll be responsive. So we just thank you for your goodness towards us, God. In your mighty name, amen. Bless you guys. Just like to invite Kim up now to do a honouring introduction of Dean. And bless you, Kim. Thank you.
I have to do a couple of admin things as well. So indulge me for a few minutes and also tell us how come we're here tonight. First of all, thanks. Giving thanks is so important. So thanks first to Mark and Donna and Dave and Heather and Gateway family. We love you. Thank you for opening your house to us. Really, really appreciate it. I need to honour a couple of people in the room. First and foremost, an absolute saint, warrior, apostle, mother in the faith, Paulette Cairns. Paulette is the founder and director of Rahab. Paula has the interesting title as the apostle to the prostitutes in Australia. She runs Rahab Ministries, which has, I think, currently 23 outreaches around Australia. Have a talk to her later. Thank you, Paulette. Who else is here? Tony and James Scammell, who are hosting Dean, fantastic leaders in the community. Cherie Lind, a co-conspirator on the World Prayer Assembly Oversight. Mike Hay, you're dangerous. He does all sorts of stuff in bringing the body of Christ together. Mark Woodry from Advocates International and the Bible Society, and a mighty man of God that has been facilitating for years bringing us all together. Jordan Mullins here somewhere up the back. If I leave you out, it's by... yeah, that's right. Well, 5 weeks ago, I was dead. I was on the... They'd stopped my heart and ripped my chest open and did a triple bypass. So the fact that I'm here and speaking is pretty miraculous. God's good. There's a bunch of others around. I haven't got everyone, but we love you all and we're glad you're here. Also, Mario and Eliza Stolls. They get a special mention because they're family. And in the kingdom, family is everything. Amen. So how did we get here? Well, we drove by car from where we're staying at the moment, as did most of you. Dean came all the way from Kansas City, but that's not what I'm talking about. How did we get to the point where Australia, Oceania in fact, is hosting the World Prayer Assembly? Rewind to May last year, I found myself in Jakarta, in Sentsel City, at the World Prayer Assembly, speaking on behalf of Oceania. I spoke in the opening session on the first day and I said to Jason Hubbard, who's the head of the, a lot of acronyms here, the IPC, the International Prayer Council, International Prayer Connect, which represents something like 5,000 prayer networks globally, and Dean's part of that. I said, mate, the first speaker usually sets the tone for event. He said, yep, that was it. Ever been chucked in the deep end by God? Yeah. So that was an incredible experience. I spoke on father and family and God really moved, and that was very much a tone of the event, and a lot happened. I won't go into that now, except for one thing. On Wednesday morning, Daniel Panji from Indonesia, who is the head of World Prayer Assembly in Indonesia, and he represents something like more than 500 prayer houses across Indonesia, including some that are congregations of 20,000. Wow. So Daniel and I are very close and share our hearts over a lot of things. He asked me on Wednesday, would we, Australia, host for Oceania World Prayer Assembly next year? And he suggested May. And I went, yeah, okay, let me make a few calls. So madly on the phone that afternoon, on Wednesday afternoon, my time in Indonesia, to various leaders, people like Jenny Hager, Ken Graham, who you've already met, James Condon, who you know, who's the head of Australia Praise, and many other leaders that I knew, and over the next week. And in essence, everyone said, yeah, that's a good idea. And that was a good start. So Thursday morning, we had an IPC, International Prayer Council, meeting, and we talked about it and said, yep, we'll talk to leaders and we'll let you know. Thursday night, the last session, the big closing event of the World Prayer Assembly 2022, Jason Hubbard, the head, essentially Dean's boss, gets up and says, we'll see you next year in Australia. And I went, what? I thought, dear Lord, what have you got me into? Fast forward to September, we ended up in Israel, caught up with Daniel Panji from Indonesia in Israel. That's a whole other story. And then in October, I was in the US and Dean and I really connected. And we had an IPC meeting after. There was a meeting called Finishing the Task, and a whole bunch of leaders from around the world and talking about the gospel. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a moment. But in the meantime, there was a journey going on, and the word God gave me in May for that Thursday morning meeting was the event serves the journey. The World Prayer Assembly in Australia is not just another event. It's a catalytic journey to bring together the body of Christ in prayer for the purpose of the kingdom, for the purpose of his family. I'll let you in a little secret. What's the most important thing in the world? God wants you in his family. John 3, Nicodemus and Jesus having a bit of a chat, and Jesus gets down to, how do I get saved? And Jesus says, you must be born again. When you're born, what are you born into? Mishpaha, family. Genesis 12, 3, Abraham's blessing would bless the families of the earth. Hebrew word mishpaha, which you are my mishpaha. Anyway, finishing the task, how does that work? Well, there's a group called Go Movement some of you have heard of. It's got more than 100 million people signed up to share the gospel. Have already reached 1 billion people with the gospel. Who's heard of Billion Soul Harvest? Who's heard of Finishing the Task? Who's heard of Campus Crusade? Who's heard of Youth for Christ? Youth with a Mission? Bible Society? Wycliffe Bible Translators? You probably haven't heard of All Africa Baptist, but they're included. Evangelical Catholics. And I can give a list as long as my arm. And bottom line, there's an agreement between all these evangelical organisations across many denominations, most denominations, that by the 2000th birthday of the church, which is when? Pentecost 23, just so you... 2033, which is just over 10 years from now, that the whole planet, including all unreached people groups, will have the gospel. And an unreached people group is an ethnic group of 100,000 or more, that they'll have the word of God in their own language in a form that they can consume, and there'll be a Christian presence per 1,000 people. And we are part of that. And we're actually the prayer part of that. So the World Prayer Assembly is not just a group of Christians praying. It's actually part of a global end time move of God to see everyone hear the gospel and come into the kingdom of God and become part of our family. Wow. So with that background, Dean from International House of Prayer Kansas City, with Mike Bickle and Lou Engle and so forth, credentialed up to here, and written many books, including fiction. Two in particular, Ecclesia Rising and a new one that's just come out called Blood Communion Revival, which is available here tonight. Please take the opportunity to grab a copy of either or both. Thank you. And representing the International Prayer Council for World Prayer Assembly and part of our oversight, which Cherie and myself and Jenny Hagg are on from a South Australian perspective, and having carried this thing from inception to where it's been birthed from, it's a good idea, we know this is the Lord, we have to do this, which has been my joy. World Prayer Assembly, in this nation, for this region, which includes New Zealand, Papua New Guinea, the islands, Indigenous leaders, bringing together to bring something into the world. And there's a prophetic word from Rick Ridings, who's Sukkot Hallel in Jerusalem, 24/7 prayer house, very well known in prayer circles, about what's called the Lamb's Wave that starts in Oceania, the international dateline, and goes across the world, across this region, across the world, the end time move of God. It's started. It's not happening. It's not going to happen. It has started. And this is part of it. And our wave of glory is what we're calling World Prayer Assembly 23, WPA2023.org, WPA2023.org. There's many more things I can tell you. Spend half an hour or 3 hours, but I won't. We're going to go to Dean. He's my mate. He's my friend. We connect a lot online and spent many hours together in LA. LA last October. So over to you, mate. All yours. Thank you.
Good evening. Thank you, Kim. Thank you to Gateway Church. Thank you for turning on those lights. I want to start right where Kim left off. It's interesting I think Adelaide is my seventh city. Over the last 2 weeks, I go from here to Perth, and then I finally get to go home and be with my wife again. So in a week, I fly back from Sydney to Kansas City. On behalf of the International House of Prayer, Mike Bickle and other leaders there, I greet you. On behalf of Dr. Jason Hubbard with IPC that is helping to plan the World Prayer Assembly, as Kim mentioned, I greet you. A little bit about me, just because family, relationship. I have 8 children. Thank you very much. 7 boys, 1 girl. Do not feel sorry for that girl. She is more than capable. My children came to me exponentially. Here's what that means. My wife and I, after about 4 years of marriage, she got pregnant, as is the way of things. Our first child was born. A couple years later, she got pregnant, as is the way of things. Child number 2. 1, 2. Follow the math. 4 years later, We decided to get pregnant again, expecting number 3, but we had twins. So 1, 2, 4. Sadly, my wife passed away. We were not quite to our 16-year anniversary. I had 4 boys under the age of 11 when she passed away. But God, in his beauty and mercy, brought a beauty to me, a feisty, redheaded widow, who also had 4 kids. So I had 4 boys. She had 3 boys and 1 girl. I went 1, 2, 4, 8. Now, if you plot that on a graph, the next number is very scary. Well, depending. That's if you go, well, yeah, it's either 16 or 64. And so, anyway, here I am in Australia, and I've just fallen in love with every place I've gone. I've been so welcomed and received. Thank you for making me feel very welcome. I have a desire to try to prophetically capture what is in the heart of the WPA advisory team and management team has blessed and kind of authorized. They're the ones that helped coordinate. James Condon helped coordinate this circuit across Australia because they felt that there were some clear messages that needed to be given. And so I am really interested in mobilizing for WPA, but I think the best way I can mobilize for that is actually to try to just deliver the word of the Lord that he has, regardless of whether it's connected to the event or not, build the kingdom and let the event build itself in a way. But I really want to tell you on the front end, we need Adelaide there. We need all the cities, the major cities of Australia. There's something about when a sound is clear, the moment is right, a prophetic spirit is stirring, and then there is a concentration of force that comes together in agreement and prayer with representatives from across a nation who are pooling their spiritual equity together. That's a breakthrough moment. And I believe Australia is at a breakthrough moment. I believe Oceania is at a breakthrough moment. So I don't have very many copies of the book. I apologize. I want to pick up where Kim went. But honestly, I've been struggling all day. When I come into an area, and I'm not just trying to talk about WPA, I'm trying to listen to the Lord, and I find that if there's a rich environment that's ready, then I find myself pulled in about four or five different directions. So I've been sifting and sorting through what does tonight require. And hopefully if I ramble, it's anointed rambling. And if it's just rambling, say a lot of amens and make me feel better anyway. Amen. It's already working. Okay, so to begin with, I just want to drop this thing. In 2004, our team with Lou Engle had a dream that out of the sands of time, a treasure chest was emerging, and the words that floated out of the treasure chest when it was opened in the dream spelled out a phrase, Great Communion Revival. 2004, we didn't know what it meant. We had the headline and not the story. But we prayed into it. In fact, the point of the dream was to release a gift of faith so that we would pray into it. Pay attention to your dreams. Pay attention to your dreams. Anyway, 16 years passed. We prayed into it with faith, but we didn't know what it was. All of a sudden in 2020, the Lord just starts giving dream after dream after dream. Within our team, and even dreams coming from other people that didn't know, we weren't talking about it yet. And we start to get these reports from others, and they're using this similar kind of phrase. A great blood revival, a great communion revival, a blood communion revival. All these words. And we're having dream after dream after dream, and I was tempted to go more here. I'm just going to start here, and then I'm going to go someplace else. But I do feel like I need to give this. So we have dream after dream after dream, and they're just all just kind of, oh, wow. I mean, one of them would have fueled an entire prayer movement, and we've had about 30 in the last 3 years. And we're hearing of people not just having dreams, but then we did start to talk about it. Some of you in the room might have even seen a YouTube video that Lou Engle and I did about a year ago when we started talking about it. And since then, we started getting reports of people saying, yeah, the Lord 5 years ago just started telling me I've got to take communion in a different way. I have to think about it differently, and I need to take it more regularly. So we're hearing reports 5, 7, 10 years. I shared, and Warwick said, yeah, for like 13 years, he's been taking communion daily with his wife. People getting healed, people getting delivered. See, communion is so much more than what we in the Protestant church have made it. We overreacted to a medieval Roman Catholic error. We swung so far over here that it's not all that literal stuff. And we swung so far over here and said it's so symbolic that we've made it. Jesus said, remember me. We've made it so symbolic it's forgettable. And so I pastored a church for 11 years, grew up in the church. I mean, on average, a pastor, a church, we'll do communion maybe once a month, maybe once a quarter. And in our Protestant, evangelical, charismatic churches, it's not unusual, at least from my neck of the woods, for it to be the thing you do on the fringe of the service so you can check it off the list and say you did what Jesus said, which is don't forget, remember. But we're moving from a peacetime atmosphere in the world to a spiritual wartime mentality. We just aren't in the same world we were before 2020. I don't mean war. I'm not talking about flesh and blood. Paul made that real clear, right? We don't labor with flesh and blood. But there are principalities and powers, rulers of darkness in heavenly places. And when the Western world is being re-demonized, that's what's happening. The Western world is being re-demonized, then it's no accident that the Passover storyline of judgment on the gods of Egypt and a deliverance for the people of God is going to be more and more part of the story, and communion is the new covenant expression of a Passover storyline. So the application of the blood, the understanding of the blood. I have a good friend in the 80s who had many songs you might even know and have sung. He was one of the top worship leaders in the world. And his label, his worship label, told him, you've got too many lyrics about the blood. You need to cut back on that. We're in danger of becoming a bloodless faith. Because we preach on so many other things, they're all good. But the blood is central to the story. You can't get away from it. And it's in the story far more than we know. Every dream we had, we would start to see, oh, that's pointing to this verse. And look, there it is. There it is. Sometimes obvious, but sometimes hidden. I'll give you a quick example. 400 prophets of Baal at Jezebel's table. 450 prophets of Ashtoreth dining on Jezebel's table. You see them feeding at the wicked queen's table. And then you see one prophet who's led into the wilderness to feed in a different way. And what was he fed? Bread from ravens. And he was at the brook Cherith, which is the word that you use when you cut covenant, which is a shedding of blood. So Elijah was drawn into the wilderness for a communion experience. Bread by the river blood. Well, see, this is all over. He's telling this story all over. It's a story of the atoning power of blood, the redemptive power of blood, the power of blood to judge the gods, to deliver the people, covenant power, and this has somehow grown kind of soft in our souls. And communion is meant to keep it living and fresh and dynamic. You can't believe beyond your revelation. So as our revelation of communion has moved to the margins, our understanding of the blood has moved to the margins with it, and we often pray things like, Jesus, I plead your blood. But actually, our revelation of the blood is quite small. And so that prayer, it's a good prayer, it's good language, but we are in danger of turning it into a magic formula. It's like we don't know what else to pray, so Jesus, I plead your blood. But we don't know what that means, so we don't really know what we're praying into. I think a great communion revival is coming so that we have real experiences with the real presence of Christ. We have real unity being stitched together in the body, and power being released in heavenly dimensions where it's not just a remembrance. Paul called it a proclaiming. You proclaim the Lord's death till he comes. So it's an eschatological timeline from his death on the cross to his coming again. Communion is a proclamation of every step of that triumph. I think when we take communion with revelation, and the Lord's going to give more and more, and I'm just at the beginning of this myself. I became zealous through the course of these dreams and writing this book. The reason I wrote it was because I needed to teach myself all over again the power of the blood. And so when we take it between a remembrance and a proclamation, I think a good word to start thinking is we reenact his triumph on the cross. So I'm spending more time on this than I wanted, but let me get there. Rick Ridings had this word, and he didn't call it the Lamb Wave. He didn't know what it was. Started with an open vision in, I think, 2012, and then again in 2014. Might have had another couple, but culminating kind of in 2021, Rick Ridings, a really godly, humble, but very prophetic man, directs Sukkot Hallel House of Prayer in Jerusalem. Has for many years. He's a trusted global leader. Amen. And he's had this word with at least three very distinct open visions, maybe more. But the vision that kind of unfolded over the course of each of them, in 2021, it culminates with seeing the Lord strike the staff, the scepter of his power, at the international date line. Now, he said the Solomon Islands, which is a little bit after, close. And I think as you just follow me, I think what he was seeing symbolically in the vision was Solomon's house was the house where the glory fell. And so I think the Solomon Islands is more about it was the last of the, as I understand it, the last of the oceanic islands for the gospel to come to. And I think it represents the power of the gospel to the ends of the earth and the glory of God coming in unprecedented measure. In Solomon's temple, the priests couldn't stand. The glory hit and everyone's on their face. I think it's a picture of that. But he saw it striking the international date line, and a tsunami began. And the tsunami began washing across, gaining power and strength. What, you know, the Lord striking at the internet. Well, what's the international date line? It's the place where an old day becomes a new day. Right? The old thing becomes the new thing at the international dateline. And he saw that the enemy had been so afraid of this for so many years, he had somehow glimpsed this in the mind of God, that he had raised up these mighty levies that were basically the ideologies and religions of Confucianism and Hinduism and Muslim and Confucianism, all of these things, Buddhism. He had raised up these levies in an attempt to stop that day. Now, we in our dream life had been shown that something about this Great Communion revival was going to start in 2022. It was that specific. In one dream in particular, it all adds up to 2022. So we planned a gathering in Jerusalem when the nation was still locked down. We didn't know how we were going to do it. We put it before the Lord. We gathered about 200 leaders, talked to them about it. Everyone's like, yes, we'll do it, but no one can get in. I'm talking about this more than I wanted to, but it's just too good. So, thank you. There you go. You're welcome to, oh, never mind. We had felt in 2021, the Lord had showed us something's going to add up in 2022, directing us to go to Jerusalem in 2022 and telling us that we needed to be ready for a sudden door to open. Now, this is our dreaming, praying community. And in 2021, it's locked down. We don't see any door opening. But in 2022, in simple faith, we gather for 21 days of fasting and prayer underneath Pikes Peak in Colorado Springs with a little garage that's been converted to a house of prayer, and a couple just felt years ago they were to dedicate that house, their little garage. They didn't use it for their cars. They had it fixed up with worship 24/7, and people could come in and out. They gave us the use of their home to use for the 21 days. We took communion morning and evening. We asked the Lord, show us the power of the blood. Give us more revelation. Every night there was a dream. And the Lord is just unpacking this story. Because in 2021, we were told something's going to happen in 2022. You need to get to Jerusalem in 2022. There's going to be an open door in 2022. But the door was still closed. Until we do this fast, and then, how many of y'all know Isaiah 22:22? Among intercessors, it should be a well-known verse, where Isaiah is prophesying what Jesus later quotes in Revelation, that the key of David is going to be given to him, and whatever door he opens, no man can close. And whatever door he closes, no man can open. Isaiah 22:22. So, on February 22nd of 2022, 2-2-2-2-2, we got a bonus 2 in there. February 22nd of 2022, Israel announces, all of a sudden, they went from one of the, if not the most closed nation, to the most open nation. They said, there's no restrictions. We bought our tickets in May, the Passover, Passover and Good Friday lined up on the calendar. We gathered leaders, about 200 leaders, and we just said, we called it the Global Communion Service. Hard to do that with 200 people, but it was just, don't despise days of small beginnings. We just did it. We believed for it. People came from all over. The door had opened, and we went. Well, Rick Ridings, without us knowing this, we didn't know this. In 2021, I think August of 2021 was his final vision of that tsunami. And when it happened, it would gather from Korea all the way down into New Zealand, Philippines and the islands of Oceania, Japan, Australia, New Zealand. It was going to gather an army of intercessors and evangelists that would sweep across on that tsunami toward Jerusalem. And all of the levees and barricades and barriers that the enemy had built, it was actually going to be so powerful as to sweep them away. So he has this, but now he's sitting on it for multiple years. And in 2021, at the end of 2021, he's frustrated. And he says, God, you've got to give me a sign. You've got to give me a sign. Okay, hit pause right there. While we were doing our 21-day fast and we were pondering the significance of communion and more on this cosmic side, the reenactment of the triumph of Christ, Lou just got obsessed with nuclear bombs. That was his way of imagining. We take communion and we're setting off bombs in the spirit. Right? And so he would watch explosions. He would take communion and watch explosions. The biggest nuclear bomb ever released was called the Tsar Bomb out of Russia. We're watching that. You'll know why I say that here in a minute. Rick, in 2021, asked for a sign. We were told it all adds up to 2022. The Lord opened a door for us to go while we're taking communion on a 21-day fast and go to Jerusalem, gather with other leaders. And when Rick asked for a sign, I believe it was in August, might have been October of 2021, he said, God, you've got to give me a sign. And then on May 15th of 2022, the Lord gives a sign. Now remember, it's a great communion revival. It's a Passover storyline, and it's all about the blood of the Lamb. Can we play that Lamb video? If you can kill these lights up here, that'd be great.
Взрыв сопровождался световой вспышкой необычной последующей свечения, несмотря на сплошную облачность, были видны в радиусе до...
Leave it loud. It's okay. Leave it loud. I want them to feel it.
Увеличился в объеме. Через несколько секунд после взрыва диаметр пылевого столба составлял около 10 километров.
облако медленно поднималось.
On January 15th, a submarine volcano called Hunga Tonga in the Kingdom of Tonga exploded. It had been erupting for a few weeks, but after a period of relative calm, the eruption became more and more violent over a couple of days and eventually produced a colossal explosion. The images of the eruption from space are just shocking. This thing was enormous. It basically deleted the central part of the volcano that stuck above the water, and yet this explosion was only half the story, and it caused a cascade of events around the world. And possibly was the very first time we've ever observed a particular atmospheric phenomenon.
January 15th, Tonga eruption sent tsunami waves and an air pressure shockwave around the world.
The shockwave pushed small tsunamis in front of it, so it generated tsunami in all bodies of water. And even more surprising was that when this shock wave, which moved about 300 meters per second, was over deep water, like a trench, it was pushing water at about the same speed as it was moving. So there was resonance there. It pumped energy into the wave and created a bigger wave.
So this event, the January 15th eruption, is very unique. So the last similar event would have been 1883 Krakatoa in Indonesia. That killed tens of thousands of people.
The sound of the eruption was heard in many parts of the world, as far away as the US.
You can clearly see where the plume of ash is spread by the number of lightning strikes in satellite imagery. By one count, in 3 hours, the eruption produced 400,000 lightning strikes.
The pressure wave from the explosion can reinforce those tsunami waves. One of the really interesting things is actually this atmospheric forcing. One, it's amazing in terms of all around the world, you know, you actually see this wave traveling around the world multiple times.
The displaced air bunched up with surrounding air to create what we call an overpressure that then radiated out as a wave. You can see it really clearly in these satellite images. This overpressure wave was so big and traveled so far that meteorological stations have been picking up its signal all over the Pacific, across the United States, and even here in the UK, 16,000 kilometers away.
So I don't want you to miss a couple of key things. It's a lamb wave. Rick Ridings has this vision, and at Tonga, which is the first nation across the international dateline, Tonga is the first nation of the new day. Since 1998, when Michael Melio was there and prophesied, under the anointing of the Lord, he prophesied that Tonga is the Psalm 110 womb of the dawn nation. And they have taken that word up and for 30-plus years been praying for a wave of revival to flow to the nations of the earth as the womb of the dawn nation. The womb of the dawn is coming, verse 4 or 5 of Psalm 110, that talks about the Lord stretching forth his rod out of Zion to rule in the midst of his enemies. The cascade of barriers, rule in the midst of the enemies. Obviously, it means many more things. But he saw him hitting that at the international dateline, which is where Tonga, the womb of the dawn, is, and the movement that followed. And he had no idea. He just asked for a sign. We were believing something's going to start in 2022. We didn't know Rick Ridings' word. He asked for a sign on January 15th, a lamb wave. circles the earth 3.5 times. Now, God promised in the last days there will be signs and wonders in the heavens. And Bob Jones always used to say, do you understand signs and wonders? You get a sign so that you wonder. In other words, you can ignore it if you want, but it's meant to make you wonder. And that is both ask a question and also respond with awe. I wonder. So a sign in the heavens, with the Lord unpacking this story called a lamb wave, also, it's a little hard to follow, but there's a wave pattern to a tsunami in the ocean. A wave is a frequency. And that wave was matched. This was what was unusual. A lamb wave is a unique phenomenon. Interesting to me, I made the connection here, Kim. The last one they said happened in Indonesia. Krakatoa. And so last year, WPA in Indonesia were coming to Australia. And the idea of the lamb wave, that it takes a tremendous amount of force to be released in the heavens. And it displaces enough air, but it's not just that, it's that the frequency of that movement in the heavens matches the frequency of the earth. So now you have the classic intercessory formula, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. So a lamb wave was released, resonating with the earth, and the earth was responding back. Praise the Lord. Well, okay, so now I want to talk about nuclear power. And I have no idea of time. All right, let's just, here we go. Set this for 2 hours, 45 minutes. No. I want to talk about nuclear power. I feel like there's something to call you to invite you to. In 1946 in San Diego, California, a small movement began that was something of a novelty among Protestants. Catholics have fasted throughout. Monasteries, monks, nuns, and Lent. Those are all Catholic traditions of fasting. This movement in San Diego was a group of Protestants that wanted to reclaim whatever had been lost. So they started experimenting with extended fasting. They would do 3 days, 10 days, then they pushed it 21 days. They started going even 40 days, some on water. Not all, but some on water. And they started seeing miracles break out. They started seeing divine answers to problems bigger than their prayers. And so Franklin Hall, who was leading this, wrote a little book. You can read it in less than an hour. It'll change your life. I encourage everyone to get it. Don't get my books. Go get this book. Atomic Power with God Through Prayer and Fasting, released in 1946. Now, he named it that for a reason, and the historians in the room may be able to figure this out. In 1945, World War II was winding down. The European theater had largely closed, but the Pacific theater was still an open question. And Japan, which was an incredible power. Now, let me say here, I always want to qualify this. Everything I'm about to say right now is not a statement about the politics or morality of a nuclear weapon. Okay? I'm not advocating something. I'm trying to talk about a dynamic of power. So, Japan was loyal to the emperor with ferocity. They believed the emperor was a divine son. And as a result, this was an honor-bound culture. They were not going to surrender. Scholars estimate, military analysts estimate, that if the war had continued, Japan was going to fight inch by inch, island by island, over hundreds, if not thousands, of islands. And the toll, the casualties, were going to range from an additional 600,000 to 1.5 million lives lost. Just slogging it out. President Truman of the United States made a difficult decision. Again, I'm not advocating. I'm saying he made a difficult decision. And on August 6th, a small bomb named Little Boy dropped, followed 3 days later by Fat Man. Fat Man and Little Boy dropped by the Enola Gay on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Fat Little Boy was the first nuclear weapon ever deployed in war. It was unimaginable power. Fat Man, 3 days later, was 80 times more powerful. And an honorable empire with no culture for surrender, 3 weeks later, surrendered. That's the point. That's why Franklin Hall, when he was discovering this power in fasting and prayer, he said, fasting is to prayer what an atomic bomb is to a conventional bomb. It takes it to orders of magnitude, greater power, and the Lord has raised up a prayer movement in the earth like nothing we've seen. There is no period in history that you can point to that has anything that compares. You can point to notable prayer movements, the Moravian prayer movement, Bangor, Ireland, 100 years plus. Alexander Achaemenes on the Caspian Sea, a tradition of monastic prayer. But those were, as profound and amazing as they were largely limited to their area. And they faded over time. They certainly weren't global events. Now, if you look at the tabernacle of Moses, it exists on many levels of symbolism. It's a picture of the human construction, body, soul, and spirit, outer court, inner court, holy of holies. It's a picture of the work of atonement and fellowship with God. But if you look at it, interestingly, as a chronology of history, from the outer court working your way in, the last step before the divine presence is the altar of incense. And the altar of incense is explained in Scripture to represent the prayers of the saints. And it also explains in Leviticus that the high priest had to make sure the room was filled with smoke. It had to be so saturated with smoke that it would seep under the veil and fill the Holy of Holies, because he's about to go through there on the Day of Atonement, and it needs to be hard to see. It was for his protection. So it had to be filled with smoke before encountering the divine presence in undiluted glory and splendor. If you look at that as a chronology, you can see that that moment, that habitation, the Feast of Tabernacles, the experience of God, Jesus tore the veil, but the picture is still relevant, that it needed to be filled with smoke. And as we move into these days for the last 20, 30 years, the earth is more filled with smoke than ever. There are more prayer movements, more coordinated prayer, more strategic prayer. Thousands and thousands of hours of prayer. Tens of thousands of houses of prayer. Hundreds of movements of prayer. And also, we're all talking to each other over Zoom. So nations are coordinated. Movements are coordinated. There is strategy in prayer and power in prayer like never before. Because I believe that picture is a chronological prophecy. The earth is filling with smoke. The king draws nigh. Well, that much prayer is, it's its own force. But there are times where something is meant to be added. And so, depending on the battle or the struggle, I can go in with a pistol or a grenade or a tank or a bomber. Depending on the battle, maybe a battle for a nation, maybe a battle for Australia, maybe a battle for Oceania, maybe a battle for the full purpose of that lamb wave to cover the earth. What if you all were the caretakers of that? What if Australia could say, that's not just a random event, it's a sign in the heavens that's meant to make us wonder what our part is? Yes. What if Oceania is looking, they've got tons of, we need to hear from them, we need to hear from the indigenous leaders, we need to hear what's on their heart and what God has been doing all over the islands, but what if God has positioned Australia as a caretaker nation for the entire destiny of the region? So he called it atomic power with God through prayer and fasting. Because to add fasting, strategic fasting, chosen fast, is to introduce a different level of power and authority. It's not something you earn, but it is something that is produced. Okay, so that little book, before Facebook, social media, any of it, it went all over the world. Miracles started to happen. Most of the healing evangelists in the late 40s and early 50s read that book, and it transformed their ministries. So Gordon Lindsay, A.A. Allen, Oral Roberts. Oral Roberts, I was born in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Oral Roberts was a frustrated young evangelist, and he wasn't seeing dramatic impact in his ministry. He's preaching. There's limited salvations. He's so frustrated. He gets a hold of the book, as did many others. T.L. Osborne, Jack Coe, so many of these guys, at least names in the United States. I know it came came around the world. I don't know how much impact it had in Australia. Some of you might be able to answer that. But as an example, Oral Roberts was so frustrated. He spent 7 months in fasting and prayer. And then in the town I moved to, my parents moved to Muskogee, Oklahoma, he got his first miracle after 7 months and prayed for a little girl afflicted with polio in a wheelchair, and she got out of her wheelchair. And the signs and wonders ministry of Oral Roberts exploded. Well, so this moved all over. And so Lou and I did my first 40-day fast in response to a call from Bill Bright, the founder of Campus Crusade for Christ. You see a number of things happening in the 40s, actually. So that movement of fasting is actually a Joel 2 event, because when there's a crisis in the land, you sound the alarm, you call the people to what? Fast. To gather. It's a solemn assembly. You call let the bridegroom come out of her chamber. It's a disruption of normal life. If you read Joel 2, the sound that goes out is saying, this isn't a normal time. It requires extraordinary attention. See, it's easy to hear the stories like I'm going to tell, and you get kind of juiced, and it's like, yeah, that's awesome, but I don't know what to do about that. And I'm not sure that I'm willing to disrupt my schedule for that. So, I get it. You can tell I'm about to call a fast, all right? I'm just telling you in advance. That's where I'm going. Leave now if you don't want to come under conviction. And please, no, I've failed more fasts. I've started more and failed more. One of my favorite stories about Lou, because he's failed even more, mainly because he's done more. They're fasting and praying right now in California for a jailbreak of 100,000 gays and lesbians to be swept into the kingdom. One of my favorite stories about Lou, though, is he woke up one morning and he said, honey, I'm going to fast. She said, what do you want for lunch? Yeah. He tells the story. I'm sorry. I'm just going to ignore my clock, okay? I'm going to fully give this. He tells the story. It's a great story. It's one of my favorite stories. Tells the story. He was on this fast, and he was really in it with the Lord. He was in a good place, but he just got weak one night, and he slipped to the refrigerator and snuck a little bit of yogurt and some chips. The next day, he's sitting in the House of Prayer in Pasadena, a place called Mott Auditorium, a revival center there. This is back in the early 2000s, I believe. And this scary prophetic intercessor lady comes along. You know of whom I speak. You are, many of you are those people. You know, the people that they're listening to the Lord. She comes along and she says, Lou, I saw you last night in a dream. And she said, and you were fasting. And Lou's like, the Lord knows. And then she said, but you were eating yogurt and chips. And then he was like, the Lord knows. Now, there's grace for this, but the point of that story actually is that not only the tender affection of God, but the sober privilege. He's, I believe, listening in a special way. He's watching in a special way. The story of Daniel is when the angel shows up, they say to Daniel, oh, Daniel, dearly beloved in heaven, greatly esteemed. This man buried in a pagan culture, probably made a eunuch in his youth, living for decades under the tyranny of pagan kings, but he's got a life with God. He is fasting and praying in accordance with prophetic assignments. When the 70 years were up, Daniel opened the scroll. He saw the word of Jeremiah was about to be fulfilled. And he did not say, well, okay, that sounds good. Let's bring the exiles back. He took it to heart and said, this is the word of the Lord. Therefore, I must lay hold of this in prayer. He fasted and prayed, and if it wasn't for the book of Daniel, we would all as intercessors be lonely and despairing because we would not know the great unseen movements, the battles of archangels. A man on his knees, fasting and praying, and archangels are moving in heavenly places. Empires are shifting. This is why when the angels show up, they're like, we have heard of you. We talk about you. You are on the radar. You need to know none of this has been wasted. He didn't look at the 70 years and say, let's see what happens. He didn't look at the lamb wave and say, hope it works out. So, first 40-day fast I did, I look at my life now. You know, there's continuity in your life. Look back over your life. You see the story. First 40-day fast I did was a communion fast. I took a piece of bread and wine in the morning, juice in the morning and in the evening. And that's what I did for 40 days. Lou and I did the same fast. We didn't know each other at the time. Many years later, we connect and we decide to write a book called The Jesus Fast. I'm going to tell this story, I'm going to give an admonition, and we'll wrap up. That sounds short. So, we're in the area around Wembley. We're trying to write this book. It's 2015. We're trying to get this book out. And we know we've got a hold of something. Lou has a fasting life. I've had a fasting life. I need to go home and start I plan on going home and starting a 21-day fast. Pray for me. But we're writing this book. We're in Wembley because Between our schedules, we just had to connect in Europe. So we're in Wembley, and there's all kinds of stuff we've been working on. But at that particular moment, we are on the chapter, I think it's chapter 8, and it's about Daniel. And the title of the chapter is Inaugurating War in the Heavens. The power of a fast to inaugurate war in the heavens. That's Daniel 9 and 10. So we've been working on this. We've been laboring over it, praying over it. We're kind of fried. We're baked. What's the Aussie term? Huh? Caught. Cooked. We were cooked. So we decided to take a break, travel from Wembley down to the bunkers that are still there as a historical museum where Churchill ran the Battle for Britain underneath the streets of London. I don't know why we thought that was a break, but we did. And the reason I do know why, it's because the point of the chapter was the church has an undetonated bomb in its arsenal. We've filled the earth with smoke. More people are praying than ever before, but we haven't yet deployed fasting at the level that I believe the Lord wants to release. So it's like an undetonated bomb in our arsenal. So we go down to the bunkers, all things Churchill. This is where Churchill commanded the war effort and the battle for Britain. The RAF storyline is relevant to us. It's a picture of gaining air superiority and intercession. You got to get above the battle. All of modern warfare has shifted through naval aviation. You don't go to war anymore sending in the ground troops. That's folly. You gain air superiority. You pummel the enemy. You break their communication systems, their supply lines, everything else. Then the army comes in and the battle's basically over. It's half done at least. So we're like, there's an undetonated bomb. We're going to Churchill. This is where he commanded the RAF, the great resistance of the battle for Britain. The Reese Howells storyline, if you know Reese Howells, praying through the battle for Britain. Intercessors at the Bible College of Wales, Swansea, Wales, saying, we will not do less on the ground in prayer than those boys are doing in the air. Saying, we are as responsible for the outcome of this war or more responsible than they are. These are the great battles of our times. Australia is in a moment. So we come back and we're just Churchill, you know, we're prophetic people. It's like the church on the hill, you know, go to the high places, all of it. We get back to Wembley and our own little undetonated bomb is the book in the hotel. And Wembley Stadium's here. Our hotel is about a 10-minute walk through this kind of commercial district. The taxi drops us off, but the streets are all cordoned off. We can't get there. We get out. We're supposed to leave the next day. And we can't get back to the hotel. We walk this way. We walk this way. Can't get there. And the policemen are all around the bobbies, and we say, what's the problem? Why can't we get to the hotel? They say, yeah, you're going to have to get a shelter for tonight. You can't get to your hotel. We can't do that. We leave in the morning. All our stuff's in the hotel. Kind of frustrated. What's the problem? Well, there's some renovations going on in an apartment here in Wembley, and the crew just found an undetonated World War II bomb. And this is in the blast radius. So they've cordoned it off because there's a blast radius around this bomb. So we set off. I got my little Google map, and I'm looking. If I go way around Wembley Stadium, we might be able to come up from the back end and be outside the blast radius. We set off walking. Have you ever walked around a huge stadium, arena? It's a long walk. So we're moving in this giant circle, and as we're moving in this giant circle, I remember a dream I had in 2001, before I ever met Lou, and in the dream, I was a bomb engineer. I was a bomb engineer detonating the nuclear bomb. And in the dream, there was a fire zone around the bomb, and I'm moving in a circle around the bomb, trying to figure out how to get to it to detonate it. Now, this is literally what's happening at Wembley. There's a blast radius, a fire zone, and I'm moving in a circle trying to figure out how to get back to us, to our little bomb book that's on the chapter about the undetonated bomb in the church, and there's an undetonated World War II bomb keeping me from getting there. So we're walking around, and the dream I had was that I finally get through and I detonate the bomb, and when the bomb goes off, immediately I think, because it's a nuclear plume, I detonate a nuclear bomb like this. And in the dream, I'm thinking, how am I still alive? Here's the interesting thing. If you've ever done a 40-day fast on water, that's what you think. How am I still alive? And in the dream, as the plume goes up, it essentially sweeps the skies clean. So this power sweeps the skies to this empty canvas. And in the dream, the gospel plays out on a screen as big as the sky. And I know all over the world, people are seeing the gospel with a clarity and a unction and an anointing that has never occurred in human history. The last words of John were, "Behold the Lamb." And this was a global beholding of the Lamb. And it's filling the sky. And in the dream, I'm thinking, this is going to change everything. Evangelism's about to happen everywhere. The gospel fades from the sky. And sure enough, all around, it's like everyone has seen. And people are just kind of stumbling around. "Can you help me get saved? Please help me. I need that. Help me. Help me." And miracles are breaking out. Organs are regrowing. Limbs are regrowing. Eyes are returning. The demonized are it's like just easy. I'm fumbling through a prayer. "God, help them. I don't," because I'm overwhelmed. People are getting saved. We work our way around. Now, I wake up from that dream on the first day of 2001. It's 3:16 a.m. I'm weeping when I wake up. I look at the clock, and it's John 3:16. I hear in the dream, I forgot to mention this, as this is happening, as the vision in the sky is playing out, I hear Mike Bickle's voice. "This is the billion soul harvest. This is the billion soul harvest." We work our way around. On the back end, we come to a little lane called Engineer's Way. I can't make this stuff up. It leads to the hotel. We get our book. We leave the next day. Is there any reason that the light horse story matters to Adelaide? Just fly. I mean, I know it means something to Australians. I'm asking about Adelaide in particular. Flying in, I could not stop thinking about the story. I had to dig in and read. I went to the place I'm staying, watched a video on it. I think it must be an Australian-made movie. It's awesome. Horses line up 6 kilometers out. They go into a trot, but then there's that moment where they run. About a kilometer or two out, under impossible odds. Gunfire, cannon fire. What they don't know is the enemy's panicking more than they are. They move toward the fight with speed. And for that generation, that was the equivalent of their atomic bomb. They were unleashing a power that the enemy didn't know how to reconcile. I'm watching this and I'm so stirred. I'm so stirred. I read a quote, one of them, "Their 1,000 hooves were stuttering thunder." Ho, 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 ho. I think I've just been kind of like, "God, what does that have to do?" I don't know what it has to do with Adelaide. I'm sitting here tonight and I felt like the Lord said, there is another light horse charge coming, but it's going to be women. I believe there is something, and I mean for Adelaide and the surrounding area, that is Psalm 68. The Lord gives the word, great is the number of women who proclaim the good news. Amen. There's a charge in the Spirit that I believe is a call to a great host of women out of Adelaide. I believe it is a call to fasting and prayer. And I believe there is a host, maybe beyond number. I don't know. But it's a great host. And I see that it is a charge of the Light Calvary where the enemy underestimates their ability. Lou had a dream that a Nazgul was attacking. Do y'all know Nazgul? Lord of the Rings? A Nazgul was attacking. It's a demon spirit. A Nazgul was attacking. The short version of the dream was that it was a Deborah call, a Psalm 68. There was a women's movement coming out of this because he woke up from the dream. He wasn't as familiar. He didn't really know the turning point of the Nazgul. In the last movie, if you've seen it, The Lord of the Rings, J.R.R. Tolkien. I was so glad that's not my phone. I thought it was. The Nazgul is attacking. The Nazgul is decimating the armies of men. They're too powerful. This Nazgul happens to hit the ground because the beast it was riding was killed. It hits the ground and it comes over to kill everyone over here. But it grabs this soldier and it doesn't know this is the maiden of Rohan. She wanted to be in the battle, but she wasn't permitted. And so she snuck into the army, dressed as a man, put the helmet on, covered her hair, and it came over and said, surrender before you die. And she said, I'm going to kill you. And he said, no man can kill me. And she rips off her helmet and her hair flows. And she says, I am no man. She plunges her sword in and the Nazgul dies. We are in a moment of a charge of women. And I'm giving a charge. I'm giving a charge. I don't know what this looks like, but I believe there's something in this moment for women to lay hold of by faith. The beauty of women is you guys talk to other women. By the end of tonight, 50,000 women are going to know. Your husbands are going to be glad. Go talk to the other women. No, go talk to the other women. There is a charge of the overlooked, the unexpected, and the newly anointed. And I'm telling you, your hair is flying free, and what no man can kill, you will bring down. And I believe there's a gate, I want to say this, I felt this earlier, there's a gate from here to Perth, a western gate, and I want to ask you to consider, I don't know what this is about, so you've got to discern of the Lord, but I'm feeling there's a western gate that is meant to be held open in prayer, that COVID shut in the natural, but it's a symbol of Adelaide's ability to pull the nation together for a moment in Perth. A moment of faith and breakthrough for the nation and for all of Oceania. Let's stand. Can we have the worship team come up, or at least someone on the keys? And come on, let's just pray. God, we're asking for a breakthrough. We're asking for Australia. If you don't know what to pray, pray in the Spirit. I don't know what to pray. Keep praying. I'm going to talk a little bit. You keep praying. I believe there's a 21-day fast. I don't know when. Fasting can be harder on a woman's body, so you got to be wise. I'm not recommending the water fast. Keep praying. Juice, Daniel fast, something. 21 days. I think there's a witness of life out of Adelaide. A witness of the womb of the mother that fights for the next generation, that bears the burden in prayer. For our children and our grandchildren, millennials, Gen Z, Gen Alpha, an outbreak of power, 21 days to drop a bomb in the spirit. I encourage you, even those 21 days, maybe take communion every day. Take communion, prophesy the Lamb wave. Hold the Western Gate open and call Australia to revival. Call Oceania to revival. God, we just declare Australia's greatest days in the spirit lie ahead. We ask from Darwin to Tasmania, from Brisbane to Perth, for a move of God. We ask as you light the cross at the heart of the nation on Easter that it would be a sign in the spirit of light breaking forth in the darkness. Mark, let's keep praying. Mark, give the sound of the light brigade, the light cavalry. Give the sound. When we do this, I want to, let's hear it. Let's hear the cry for Australia in this room. God, we're asking for our children and grandchildren. We speak life over this land. We prophesy salvation and life. Raise up the shield maidens of Rohan, the shield maidens of Adelaide. Clothe them in breastplates of righteousness. We say with Psalm 68, the Lord gives the command. Great is the host who proclaimed the good news. And then the next verse says, the kings, they flee. God, we're asking for principalities and powers to be dispelled, disbanded, dismembered, silenced, cut off, shattered, broken. Powers over this nation that have warred against its destiny. We say you've touched the mothers, and that was your mistake. I know it's late, but are there a couple of I would like a young woman and an older woman. Just a couple of you. If you're feeling a special burden to pray, I'm asking for it to be a tight prayer. But if there's a younger woman and an older woman, come up and pray with me. Come on, don't be shy. Good.
Pray for family.
Yeah. Pray for the next generation.
Yeah. Abba, we thank you
that we know you have just an amazing design for each one of our children, our grandchildren, and our great-grandchildren. And Father, we call them into design, your God's design, that they will all run past us at 1,000 miles an hour, more than what we have ever done in all of our Christian lives. Father, we thank you. It is their time, Lord. We thank you, Father, and we are going to run with that baton with them for the kingdom of God to increase in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Come, come. Come, both of you. Come. All. Does this young lady want to pray? You do. You really do. No, okay. All right, that's okay. Both of you.
Okay, let us pray. Isaiah 54, we thank you, Lord Jesus, because we sing, oh dear Lord. We thank you, Lord Jesus, because you are enlarging our wombs, you're enlarging our tents in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, Lord, we speak to this land of Australia in the mighty name of Jesus and just ask, oh dear Lord, that you pour down your spirit, oh dear Lord. Open the floodgates of heaven and let it rain, oh Jehovah Father. As we have seen that video, in the mighty name of Jesus, let there be an atomic bomb like that has never been seen before in the mighty name of Jesus. May people's heart, oh dear Lord, turn to their parents in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, Lord, to be able, Lord, to look unto you. Behold the Lamb of the that takes away the sins of the world. The Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. We thank you, Lord Jesus, because you're bringing a revival into this nation, oh Jehovah, oh God, over all the young people, all the middle-aged people in the mighty name of Jesus. Father God, we shall see you, Lord, as Lord God Almighty and not lean on our own understanding. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Lord, and we pray that the seeds of the prayer will fall on a fruitful land of this nation. Not like in the natural, but in the supernatural. It will be a fruitful land. And any seed that is placed will bring fruit. As here you can plant the seeds and grow the vegetables and fruits all year round, depending on the season. The Lord, that you'll bring the fruit of the prayer all the year round, in many generations to come. Lord, we pray that you will flourish this land, you will flourish in Australia, you will grow in Australia more and more, that it's not the deeds of the past or the awakenings of the past, but there's so much more to come. There is so much more in the future that you want to do in Australia, how you want to bless this nation, how you want to work through the people of this land, Lord. And we ask that you will put your pillars of faith, Lord, in every church, and you will grow the church, you will grow the bride of Christ in this land, that this land will be a loving bride of Christ who is in love, who is her King.
Thank you. Here's what I want to do to close. If wherever you are as a man, I want you to, if it's your spouse, be with your spouse. But I don't want any woman in this room left unprayed for. Turn to your spouse, turn to other women, and men, I'm asking you to pray a new anointing, new authority, a new sense of purpose and power over their lives. Wherever they are, ladies, just stay put. If there's a single lady somewhere that doesn't have a man nearby, somebody go and gently touch her shoulder. Be respectful. I want us to release a blessing on these women, and I want it to be a sign in the spirit for Adelaide. God, we call these daughters of the King. We bless them. God, we ask if there has been animosity or deficiency of relationship between husband and wife. We ask even tonight in this prayer it would be healed. I ask for a spirit of repentance and humility to come on the men. God, we say we need these mighty women of God, the great hosts, to rise. We say the daughters of a lion are a lion. We ask for authority to be in their mouths. That the great love you put in their heart would be a force to be reckoned with in this day. We proclaim release, release and blessing. Father, smile on your daughters tonight. Smile on your daughters tonight. Summon them and commission them. God, I'm praying for the women leading this worship time. Anoint them like never before. God, make them fruitful in the home, fruitful in their business, fruitful in their family, fruitful in intercession. Call them, reveal them, summon them, catch them up. God, I'm asking for dreams. I'm asking for you to impart a dreaming spirit. Dreams in the night, divine strategies for intercession. Coordinate this supernaturally, God. Even as the sound goes out, coordinate this supernaturally. Beyond the scope of this meeting, let a word ripple through Adelaide. Train their hands for war. 21 days, God. I don't know which period that is. I feel like it's sometime in May. 21 days. Open the Western Gate. Prophesy over Australia. Behold the Lamb. Steward this moment in prayer. Someone had mentioned earlier, and I've forgotten, this lady reminded me, of course, Adelaide is a queen city. Come on. This young lady is going to lead us. We're going to close with this. What is your name? Bella. Bella. Bella's the daughter, right? Yes? Okay. So Bella is going to lead us in a simple prayer, and I want us to repeat with her. So she's going to say on the microphone, Australia, behold the Lamb. It's a declaration in the spirit. She just looks so beautiful here. Her hair's flowing free. Australia, behold the Lamb. And we're going to say that with her three times. Amen? With faith and agreement. So Use your outside voice, not your inside voice. Be strong. I'll hold the mic, and you're going to say, Australia, behold the Lamb. And we're going to say it with you three times. Okay? Ready? One, two, three.
Australia, behold the Lamb. Australia, behold the Lamb. Australia, behold the Lamb.
Yes! Behold the Lamb of the Lamb wave washed across. Amen and amen. Bless you, Lord. God, I ask you to seal up tonight. I ask you to stir in your people hope and faith here in this queen city. Wow. Gosh. Amen and amen. Bless you.